All right, thank you. Well, this will be a slightly less rushed look at some data than we had right before the break. We got some great overview data, and we're going to dig in a little bit on a couple of specific issues. One is the relationship between jury trial and the length of trials, and the other is the relationship between bench versus jury trial and outcomes. As previously indicated, several years ago, I published a paper that, to our surprise, frankly, and the surprise of a number of trial lawyers, found that there is essentially no effect whatsoever between the length of a jury trial, or for that matter, the length of a bench trial, and the outcome. Right? So the received wisdom I heard from a number of trial lawyers was patentees, the plaintiffs, liked short jury trials. They didn't want the long, complicated trial. Turns out it didn't make a difference at all. We did find in that earlier paper that, consistent with what all previous work had found, juries tend to rule for patentees more often than judges, and juries in some districts that have been under discussion as part of patent reform, including the Eastern District of Texas, were modestly more pro-patentee than juries in the average district. So what we did in this case was update that study in a couple of important respects. One is we added 5 new years of data, bringing it through the end of 2015. So we've now got just over 1,000 jury verdict judgments running from the beginning of 2000 to the end of 2015. We also brought in 2 important new variables. One is the area of technology, because there are very significant differences by area of technology in all kinds of patent respects. And second is patent entity status. Are you a practicing entity? Are you a non-practicing entity? And if the latter, what kind of non-practicing entity are you? So here's the basic trial outcome findings. So a couple of things to note here. About 3/4 of all trials in patent cases are jury trials. We still have just over 1/4 that are bench trials, but most of them are jury trials. Patentees win bench trials 54% of the time in whole, and another 7% of the time they win in part. So the middle category here breaks down patentee wins, that's C for claimant and CD for claim defendant. We didn't want to say plaintiff and defendant because we've got declaratory judgment cases. So patentees win 54% of the time outright. They win another 7% a partial win in front of judges. They do better than that in front of juries, winning 62% of the time outright and another 6% of the time they get a partial win on some but not all patents or some but not all claims. One thing we find, I think, consistent with our prior work, but it's a very striking finding that you'll see through throughout all of this data, jury trials take longer than bench trials. That's true wherever you look, as we'll see in a moment. The mean time for a jury trial was 8.3 days. The mean time for a bench trial was 5.9 days. That's a significant difference, quite statistically significant difference. Where we do not find any difference is in outcomes. So you look at the differences between jury verdicts for plaintiffs and jury verdicts for defendants, for example. Both have a mean of 8.2 days. Bench trials, again, no statistically significant difference between the patentee wins and the defendant wins in terms of the length of the trial. So the length of the trial doesn't seem to make any difference whatsoever in the outcome. Yes, Judge. So the answer is we did our best to do that, but it is imperfect because there's no way to actually get the records for what time did they start and end for each case. What we did was actually get sort of daily minute notes and indications of mornings and afternoons. But I had a conversation with a judge this morning who said, "Oh, I was with a jury and they wanted to get done before the holidays, so we started at 8:15 in the morning and we ran until 8:30 at night." And I don't think I can, you know, I don't think I have that reflected in this data. The We break this out by district, so we looked at the five most significant districts, and then we looked at everywhere else. Eastern District of Texas, a couple of things to note about this. So same basic structure, doesn't matter whether it's long or short in terms of the outcome. Jury trials take longer than bench trials, right? But note one thing that's happened, which is both the bench and the jury trials are shorter in the Eastern District of Texas than they are nationwide. So this is nationwide, 5.9 days for bench trials and 8.3 days for jury trials. By contrast, it's 3.6 days for bench trials and 5.9 days for jury trials in the Eastern District of Texas. That's probably not too surprising. They're very busy people with quite a patent docket. And as we indicated, it doesn't make a difference to the outcome. We do see slightly higher win rates in the Eastern District of Texas, but only slightly higher. So this was the national 53.4% bench trial win and a 62% jury trial win. Here it's 55.6% bench trial win and a 65% jury trial win. But not, I think, a significant difference, and it turns out not a statistically significant difference from the national average. So the sort of received wisdom that the Eastern District of Texas is pro-patentee, at least when it comes to what happens in the outcome of a jury, when it makes it to the jury, doesn't seem to be borne out by the evidence. There's a slight increase in the win rate, but nothing of great significance. Northern District of California, by contrast, both longer trials and particularly longer jury trials, not especially longer bench trials, but a lower win rate. Interestingly, not a lower win rate on bench trials, especially, but a definitely a lower win rate for the patentee in jury trials. This is the lowest win rate of the significant districts in the Northern District of California. It is also the case that they are the longest jury trials, although, again, in the Northern District of California, there's not much distinction. Here there is a kind of barely statistically significant difference between long and short trials, but it goes in the opposite direction from the way we thought it would go. Longer trials actually benefit the jury, the plaintiff, not the defendant, in the Northern District of California. Central District of California runs about average in terms of outcomes, 50% patentee win rate, 60% jury win rate. They do have particularly short bench trials in this case, shorter than anywhere else, only 2.7 days on average. District of Delaware, now here we start to see something interesting. The win rate for patentees in the District of Delaware is higher in a bench trial than it is in a jury trial. That's a surprising finding given what we know nationwide, although I think actually we'll see an explanation for that in a moment when we get to area of technology. Delaware, unlike some of the other districts we've talked about, is starting to hear a lot of pharmaceutical cases. Delaware cases are also kind of about the mid-range in terms of time to trial. They do have some more complexity in the jury trial. You'll see 18% split verdicts in Delaware, which is higher than pretty much anywhere else. Finally, one district where we know there are a substantial number of pharmaceutical cases is the District of New Jersey. Note the bench trials. 75% of the trials in the District of New Jersey are bench trials. That is overwhelmingly because those are pharmaceutical ANDA cases for which there is, it is agreed, no right to a jury trial because only injunctive relief is at stake, the defendants usually not having entered the market at risk. Patentees win bench trials at about the same rate there they do nationally. They win jury trials at a slightly lower rate, but again, not terribly significant. The trials are in New Jersey tend to be longer, both bench and jury trials, than elsewhere, and that might be a function of the pharmaceutical cases, although I was interested to hear Judge O'Malley say, well, maybe we need more time in a computer than in chemical cases. That doesn't seem to be what we've got, at least in the District of New Jersey. And this is everywhere else. This is, as you heard before break, a minority of the cases are filed in all of the other districts in the country. One thing we do see is that the win rates in the bench trials are a little bit lower elsewhere in the country, and the win rates in jury trials are a little bit higher elsewhere in the country. That's an interesting finding, right? The win rates in districts other than the Big Five are higher than they are anywhere in the Big Five, including the Eastern District of Texas, for jury trials. And that's a fact that I think people haven't paid a great deal of attention to of late. All right. What happens when we break this down by area of technology? So let's take a look first off at chemistry. Not surprisingly, in the chemical cases, more bench trials, higher win rates for plaintiffs both in the bench trials and in the jury trials. This is consistent with other work that Dave Schwartz and I have done, among others, across win rates overall in chemical cases. Patentees in chemical cases do better than patentees in other areas as a general matter, and you see that reflected here, a 72% win rate in the jury and a 64% win rate in bench trials. Contrast that with computer and communications, and here I think we see a really interesting finding, right, which is that the bench trial win rate, admittedly with a small number of cases in computer bench trials, is quite small, right, 15%, but if you make it to a jury with your computer and communications case, your win rate is 61%, right up there in the normal average, right, so the computer patents, which have been, I think, the focus of a lot of criticism in patent reform, at least when they make it to a jury trial, do just as well as patents on average. Drugs and medicine, like chemistry, do better than average, winning both in the bench trials, where most of them are held, and in the jury trials at a higher rate. So that, I think, is consistent, at least with conventional wisdom. Electrical and mechanical patents, we also include, and other patents, not in any of those five categories. One of the things we find is that the electrical patents, compared to the sort of computer software patents, actually do relatively well. So electronics and semiconductor patents actually do pretty well in court compared to other types of patents. Finally, we broke down by who the plaintiff is. If for purposes of this study, we broke you into three categories: a practicing entity, a patent assertion entity, and an individual. There are other kinds of plaintiffs that are not included here because they turn up to only in very small numbers, like sort of failed startups that are still asserting the patents that they had as startups, or universities assert some patents, but they don't assert quite a few. There are very few that make it to trial. So what do we see here? Practicing entity. First thing to note is the trial times, which are surprisingly small in jury cases. Big company or company versus company cases, practicing entity plaintiff cases, have relatively short jury trials, which was a surprising finding to us. They do pretty well. They do better than the overall average. Practicing entities win 61% of the time in bench trials and 69% of the time in jury trials. Patent assertion entities, by contrast, don't do all that well in bench trials. Again, small numbers, only 29%, but it's a fairly small N. They do a little less well than average in front of juries, but not all that poorly. So the patent assertion entity business model, which is get me to a jury, turns out to be a wise business model. One of the things that Dave Schwartz and John Allison and I have found in other work is that if you look not just at jury results, but across all win rates, the patent assertion entity win rates are abysmal. They are less than 10%. Right, so the fact that patent assertion entities win less than 10% of their overall cases, but they're doing just fine when they show up in a jury trial, suggests that the game of getting the case to the jury trial is in fact something that patent assertion entities are right to try very hard to push for. And finally, we were quite interested in the individual plaintiff work, again, because individuals do pretty poorly overall in patent cases. They tend to have a lot of their cases thrown out at summary judgment, but when they make it to trial, they actually do quite well. both in front of judges and in front of juries. In fact, they've got the highest win rate of anybody in this study. And that was quite interesting finding for us. It's hard to know, of course, how much of that is driven by selection effects. We've done a better job of weeding out the cases early on. But it might also be a function of the nature of the story that the plaintiff has to tell once they make it to trial, and the individual plaintiff may have a more attractive story to tell. If you look at the causal factors that go into what makes a trial long or short, here's what we can show you. Having a jury lengthens trial time. It lengthens it substantially, lengthens it by about 3 days on average. Having a trial in the Eastern District of Texas shortens your jury time by about 3 days. So Eastern District of Texas is associated with much shorter jury trials. Delaware, shorter jury trials. Northern District of California, shorter jury trials. By contrast, Northern California and New Jersey are both associated with longer trials. Computer and communications cases tend to have longer trials on average than others. Mechanical cases are shorter. Drug and medical cases are also longer. So we've got a number of factors that go into how long your trial is going to be. Though remember, as we said at the outset, it doesn't matter ultimately to the outcomes very much how long your trial is. Might matter to the lawyers, of course, might matter to the court and the jury quite a bit, doesn't seem to affect the outcomes very much. When we try to predict what influences a patentee win rate, well, we have a couple of significant predictors. The most significant predictor is jury trial is, in fact, associated with an increased chance that the patentee is going to win. So plaintiffs who want to get to juries are right to want to get to juries. They're more likely to win in front of juries. They are less likely to win statistically in the Northern District of California. They're less likely to win if they've got a computer or communications patent by about 8 percentage points. They're somewhat more likely to win if they've got a drug or a medical patent, and they are less likely to win significantly if they are a patent assertion entity. So all other things being equal, jury trial is the biggest driver here, but there are a number of other factors that that help us predict whether or not the patentee is going to win their jury trial. All right, so what can we learn from this? Well, generally, trial length doesn't impact outcome. In fact, to the extent there's any statistically significant indication, it's one that goes against the prevailing wisdom, and it's specific to one district, the Northern District of California, where longer jury trials actually benefited patentees. Juries are somewhat more pro-patentee nationally than district judges are, and that's also true in both the Central District of California and the Eastern District of Texas. But judges are more pro-patentee than in the Northern District of California and the District of Delaware. The bench trial win rates are actually higher there. They're nearly identical in the District of New Jersey. Patent assertion entities and individuals do worse than practicing entities, but not by very much. And indeed, in some respects, as we saw, individuals do better. So what do we still have to do? One thing we have to do, both of these things are related. One thing we are in the process of doing but have not yet done is separating out bench trials where the parties went to bench trial because they had no choice. Those are a few cases against the government under 1498 and ANDA cases in which there's no damages claim and therefore there's no right to a jury trial because the case is at equity. And one of the things we want to do is pull those out and find out what happens in bench trials where people could have chosen to go to a jury but instead went to the district court. And then second, what we hope to do is actually to follow up with the lawyers in those cases and ask them the question, why did you choose a bench trial over a jury trial? The evidence coming into this paper and supported by our findings is that patentees do better in front of a jury. So the question is there a story there? Is there some reason that people are in a small but not insignificant number of cases choosing bench trials as patent plaintiffs, even though they could choose a jury trial? Does that choice make sense? Is it, well, we were unsophisticated, we didn't know that we should seek a jury trial? Was it, we think we have a particularly unsympathetic plaintiff or a particularly sympathetic defendant? Is there some other explanation that's causing a decent chunk of people to choose bench trials even when they don't have to? And that's it.
So this is basically the standard, probably empiricist response. You give a sentence to selection effects, and you have a very strong conclusion about how you want to be in front of a jury as a plaintiff. And I just wondered if you could say a little bit more about, I mean, clearly it's an unusual subset in both the jury side and the bench side, the stuff that comes fully to trial. And there's going to be all kinds of, whether weeding out at pretrial or, I think especially, selection effects. Pressuring settlement, and you know, breaking it out in various ways, I think will help with that. But I just wonder what you've thought about, and maybe this is partly thinking about next steps too. How do we conquer, I think, the really difficult question of making sure we have comparables on one side and the other when we make our comparison?
Yeah, so look, the answer is, right, it's hard to know, right? I think I can predict with great confidence, with some greater confidence, right, that sort of good patents do better than bad patents, right? But of course, how do we know what's a good patent, what's a bad patent, right? We don't have any useful baseline for which to measure that. So, are there selection effects? Absolutely, there are selection effects. Things that make me more comfortable in the conclusion that there is a jury trial relationship here are the fact that it is true across every technology area. That it's true that juries do better, that plaintiffs do better in front of juries than they do in front of judges. It's true across almost every type of entity. It's true across every district, right? So a lot of the things that you might sort of say, well, all right, what's driving this? Maybe it's that people are sort of choosing choosing juries or choosing judges at a disproportionate rate in some cases, don't seem to be affecting the results, right? That all of the technology areas, almost all of the entity types, all of the courts see this effect, right? And that suggests to me that there's something real going on here. That said, one of the things we hope to do by actually doing the survey methodology is to try to tease out what is it that might be different about the people who are choosing to go to bench trial rather than jury trial. Now, obviously, if you aren't choosing it, if you're in the ANDA cases, that's an important thing. We ran in the old paper control for ANDA. It doesn't affect the results. ANDA cases do quite well, but that actually strengthens the results a little bit. Right, so plaintiffs do less well in bench trials than in jury trials, but plaintiffs in general do better in pharmaceutical cases than they do anywhere else. So the fact that those pharmaceutical cases are mostly bench trials, I think, actually ends up strengthening the findings. But I hope we'll find out an answer. Right, maybe there is a selection effect. Maybe it's hometowning or quality of lawyering or something about who the lawyers are. Right, that sort of sorts people into bench versus jury trials in a way that would be.
Mark, I think it's somewhat deceptive to compare the length of a bench trial with a jury trial, because every bench trial I've ever been in, I haven't been in a patent one, but the judge, you know, you get 2 hours Friday afternoon, then you come back next week on Wednesday for 3 hours in the morning, then you come back a month later for another 3 hours, and then you wait for 3 months to get an opinion or to come back after there's a it's just so... How do you even keep track of the time?
So this is
a non-jury case.
This is a hard problem, and it goes to Judge O'Malley's question earlier. And the answer is we struggled quite a bit with how to get access to that information. I do think you're right that bench trials are a lot more fragmented than jury trials. Right? There's an instinct to get the jury out the door and done as soon as possible. Right? Because we're taking those people away from their lives. That said, I think that makes it all the more interesting, right, that the bench trials are shorter than the jury trials, right, because we're measuring in basically half-day chunks, and if the answer is we're going to do our bench trial in a much more piecemeal way, you might think, well, that should take longer, right? We should actually have more time because you got to remind the judge of what's going on if they haven't been back for 2 months, or we're going to have only a couple of pieces here and there. The other problem, which we kind of tried very hard to get a handle on, but which I think may actually be related here, is that it might be the case that a bench trial is going to be piecemeal patent litigation more often than a jury trial is, right? So a judge might decide, well, all right, I can resolve the infringement issues on summary judgment. I don't need a trial on that, but I'm going to hold a trial on the invalidity issues. And it might be more likely that a jury trial presents both of those issues. If that's true, it turns out, of course, to affect our results. We did a couple of things to try to deal with that problem, right? One is that we actually pulled out and excluded trials that appeared to be only on a particular discrete issue. So bench trials only on inequitable conduct, for instance, we ended up pulling out and measuring separately because we feared that a trial that was only on a kind of small subset of normal patent issues would naturally be a shorter trial than the others. So we kind of tried to get at that. The other thing we do is we have as a kind of nice measure of complexity split verdicts, right? So in the cases where there's a trial with a partial patentee win and a partial defendant win, that's some indication of a kind of more complicated trial process, and those almost always took longer than the trials that led to either a pure plaintiff win or a pure defendant win. We actually have a couple of controls in the data set for how many patents are at stake in the case. Are there patents on both sides so that people are cross-suing each other? Again, as measures to try to control for things that might cause a longer time in the jury. So I think it's a worry. We're trying to do something about it, but I'm not sure that we can get as precise a measure as we'd like to get.
Yeah, I have a quick question. Are there analogous statistics available for PTAB proceedings? That is to say, if we look at PTAB proceedings like a kind of quasi-bench trial, is there some difference in the percentage of outcomes in terms of wins?
Percentage of outcome, there are percentage of outcome statistics on PTAB. It's a little complicated because it's a funneling process, right? So early numbers got a lot of people alarmed about the PTAB because a lot of the decisions by the PTAB were invalidating patents, although that's the end of a process in which they've decided to institute the proceeding, right? So they've already weeded a bunch out there, and then the parties haven't settled and so forth. When you factor in how many people petition and then pull out settlements at various stages, the data I've seen most recently suggests that the PTAB invalidates patents at a 43.2% rate. That is within a couple of percentage points of the overall invalidation findings in district courts, when you count both trial and summary judgment. So on outcomes, the answer is the preliminary evidence we have suggests that it's not radically different in terms of invalidation. The trial, of course, is a very different beast. There isn't really a PTAB trial in the same way. So in terms of time, I think it's going to be a different story.
Professor Lemley, really fascinating data. I, like the first questioner, have some questions myself about whether the cases that go before juries and judges are different. So I want to propose an addition to your survey study of lawyers, and that is in a set of jury cases that you ask the professional judge what decision they would have made in the case before them. And maybe there are even some judges in this room who might be interested in cooperating in that kind of study.
Right. I think that would be very interesting. My sense in, not in patent cases, but in general, and obviously there are district judges here who can give their own sense, is that district judges seem to think the jury gets it right most of the time. But I'm not sure if that's true in patent cases. Judge Young might have an opinion on this.
The problem with that is that the judge only weighs in after the verdict. And
Maybe we can persuade Judge Young to write down in a secret sealed envelope how he would vote before the jury, but I doubt it.
Well, thank you, Mark. Thank you. Please join me in thanking Mark.